Good morning, Circle Church. How are you all? Everyone that's in here, how y'all doing? Praise God, praise God. We are thankful to see the very first Sunday in May. Hallelujah. God, you are so good. You are so wonderful. Thank you for saving us. Thank you for bringing us to this moment, Father. We will not waste a second of it, God, but we're going to do everything we can to give you glory, give you praise, give you honor, because that's what you deserve, God. We'll give you the air in our lungs today, God, to worship you, to praise your name. We invite you to do that here in this room. We invite you to do that out there in live stream land. It is a great day. I feel like it's going to be a good one. Y'all agree? Amen. Well, let's go. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord. Free today is the same. Free to lift my hands and worship, Lord, I'm free, Lord, I'm free. Free to dance and sing, free to lift my hands and worship, Lord, I'm free, Lord, I'm free. I'm a free worshiper, I'm a free worshiper, I'm a free worshiper. I'm a free worshiper. I'm a free worshiper. I'm a free worshiper. Lord, I'm free. That I'm free to dance, yeah. Free to lift my hands and worship, Lord. I'm free. Lord, I'm free. That I'm free to dance. Worship, Lord, I'm free. Lord, I'm free. I'm a free worshiper. I'm a free worshiper. I'm a free worshiper. Lord, I'm free. Say, I'm a free worshiper. Yeah. I'm a free worshiper. Lord, I'm free. Lord, I'm free. And I thank God I'm free, and I'll never be bound again, yeah. I thank God I'm free, yeah, and I'll never be bound again. Said I thank God I'm free, and I thank God I'm free, and I'll never be bound. No more shame, no more depression, I'm free. I thank God I'm free. Thank God I'm free. And I'll never be bound again. I'm walking here from the Lord again. Thank God I'm free, yeah. And I'll never. Yeah. Say I'm a free worshiper, Lord, I'm free. I'm a free worshiper, Lord, I lift my hands to worship you, God. Lord, I'm free. Lord, I'm free. Lord, I'm free.
God, we thank you. Thank you for freedom. There is freedom in this house today. We invite you to receive it. We invite you to receive it. We are thankful to have the King of Glory rest in this place. Hallelujah, Jesus. Glory to God. Oh, he's so wonderful, he is. Yes. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Yes, the world will bow down and say you are God. And every man will bow down and say you are King. So let's start.
So all we have to do is follow you, Lord God. Hallelujah. We're so grateful to you. So grateful to you, Lord God. Hallelujah. We declare that there's none like you in heaven or in earth. Hallelujah. There's none like you, oh God. And so today we got, God, we just bless and honor you today. We thank you for this gathering of people. We thank you, Lord God, that you've kept us safe up until this day, Lord God. Hallelujah. No hurt, harm, or danger, Lord, came upon us, but Lord God, you brought us together, Lord, in corporate worship to bless and honor your holy name. And so we yield to you right now, sir. We say, come in and have your way, Holy Spirit. Do what only you know how to do, Lord God. Do the way you want it to do, Lord God, in and through us in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you, Lord God. We thank you. We thank you for what you're doing, what you've done, and what you're going to do, Lord God, in us. Lord God, we trust you that we'll never be the same after today, Lord God. We thank you that after we hear the words, Lord God, that it will resonate on the inside of us, Lord God, and we'll walk out of here changed, hallelujah, by the word and the word only, Lord God. We pray for Pastor Vince right now that you cover him, Lord God. Keep him, Lord God. Help him to say what you want him to say, Lord God. Hallelujah. And we thank you that it's the words of God flowing through him, Lord God, and we'll receive it with meekness. We bless and honor you in all that we do, Lord God. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hallelujah. Woo, God, we thank you for freedom. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Woo, we're alive because he's still alive. Ha ha, we serve a risen Savior. Glory to God. And we are going to surrender, submit, and receive today the freedom of God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. I remember how it was, but it ain't that way no more. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I was lost with a broken heart. You picked me up, now I'm set apart. From the ash, I am born again. Forever safe in my Savior's hands. And you were more than my word to say. I'll follow you, Lord, for all my days. I'll fix my eyes following your ways. Forever free and unending grace. Cause you are my freedom. We lift you higher. We lift you higher. Your love never ending. Oh, you are alive.
take your place.
Yeah.
You are all we need. Your love has set us free.
Oh, 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 oh. Hallelujah. Oh, you are
oh, 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 oh. Set your son down and set him free. Everything of this world will fade. I'm pressing on till I see your face. I will live and your will be done.
Hallelujah.
And I won't stop till your kingdom comes.
My freedom, we lift you higher. We lift,
sing it with us.
Say you are my freedom. We lift you higher. We lift you higher. You are my freedom. We lift you higher. You lift you higher. You are my freedom. We lift you higher.
Your love,
we lift you higher. Your love,
never is enough. Oh, 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 oh,
oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh,
makes me happy. Hallelujah. Oh, to be free. I can tell somebody else who's bound about the one who sets us free. He set us free. He set us free. And I am free. Praise the Lord, I'm free, no longer bound, no more chains hold me, my soul is resting, it's just a blessing, praise
just a blessing. Praise the Lord, hallelujah, I'm free. And we thank you, God. And we thank you for freedom, Jesus. We thank you for freedom, Jesus. Woo! We thank you for freedom. Hallelujah. Woo, everybody take a deep breath. Woo. Woo, we breathe in your freedom today, God. Hallelujah. Woo, we surrender, we submit it, we receive your freedom, God. Hallelujah. Jesus, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Oh, tell you two things that I just heard, what's been spoken in worship today. You need a fresh reminder of where you've come from. You need a fresh reminder of I know you may have been saved all your life. You may have been saved from a child. But you need a reminder of where you come from. You need a reminder of the sin that you were in that Jesus came and got you out of. You need a reminder of that. Now, why am I telling you that? Because before that, you were in bondage. And again, I wish Pastor Lois was here to say it a whole lot differently, because there are people that he works with every day who think about what they would do with their time once they got free. And here you are, out, not bound, Cujo, free indeed. You don't have to, oh Lord, you don't have to wonder what it's like to be free, because you are. So sometimes, like, listen, I want to make sure it don't take all that. If you knew, how locked up I really was, you'd be taking a lap for me. Because now that I'm free, because listen, it ain't just free to worship. It's free around you. It's free at work. It's free when I'm in the grocery store. It's free from other people's opinions. I get to be free. Heard that in worship. This is what I heard in quiet time this morning. Now let me make sure I'm saying this, communicating this the right way. The Lord affirms me when I read scripture. I don't just hear things out of nothing. As long as it comes back to scripture, I'm okay with saying it. I'm gonna tell you this. I know who it's for, but I want to remind you this real quick. The Lord shares with me, I'm gonna share it with you. You are not going to regret being obedient. You're not going to regret it. If God told you, and here's the thing, and the reason I need to tell you that this morning is because it doesn't make a lot of sense right now. The decisions that you are having to make,
would be a lot easier if you did it another way. But that ain't what the Lord told you to do. And you're struggling with, man, I don't, really? Like, I would rather do it another way. But here's what I want to tell you. It's not always greener. It's not always greener. It's not always greener. And so you're thinking about being disobedient because it looks, and here's the thing. Now, y'all, listen, we all know that, here's what I mean by big disobedience. Like, you know you shouldn't do that sin, or you know you shouldn't do this. But I'm talking about the small stuffs. I'm talking about like that faithfulness God told you to be faithful to, about that one thing he told you to do. Talk about that job that you at that you don't know why you at. I'm talking about that relationship he keeps pushing you in on that you don't know why you're talking about it. I'm talking about that issue that you've been communicating with a friend who wants to know Jesus, and you think it'd be really easy if you just made this caveat to let them come open and be in, but you don't feel like doing it. Here's what I'm trying to tell you. You're not going to regret being obedient. It works out for you in the end. It works out for you right now. You being obedient is already working for you. You just don't see the result yet. But it's already working for you. Your obedience will have a prize. Woo, say that again. Your obedience will have a prize. Well, my prize is Jesus. Yes, and your Jesus is a good giver. And he likes to give good gifts. Well, I just want, your prize should be Jesus. Yes, but here's what I know. Because I love him so much, because he loved me so much, man, he is be giving stuff. You're not going to regret being obedient. You better do what he told you to do. Go backwards. And that's why people can be so free. It's hard to be free when you're being disobedient. Really hard to be free when you're being disobedient. I don't know why. I'm like, God's not blessing your disobedience. Can he work that thing around for his glory and your good? Yeah. But hear me, child of God. God didn't change his rules on sin. I don't know why I'm feeling that thing right there, but he ain't changed his rules about it. So if you feel the need to let somebody else in on it, well, it's not, nah, just be obedient. Just be obedient. Just be obedient. I don't even know where to go. Let me pray, and then we go sit down against his word. Lord, we thank you for this freedom that we have in you. God, we thank you that that freedom can come from being submissive to a holy God. God, thank you for pushing us to trust you. When we don't want to do it, somehow you egg us on into trusting you. God, thank you for those moments when you brought me to the altar when I ain't gonna bring myself there. God, thank you for those moments when you brought forgiveness out of me when I didn't want to forgive. God, thank you for those moments when you kept my tongue together when I didn't want to keep it together. God, thank you for making me trust you. Father, I pray for all who are gathered here this morning that they would be able to worship you in this freedom that's in spirit and in truth. So we need to hear from that spirit and truth this morning that's found in your word. God, help us to dig deep. We find a word to rescue our weary heart. So let the words of my mouth and meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Speak to us right now. God, speak from heaven this morning. Oh God, would you speak from heaven this morning? In the mighty name of Jesus, the people of God said, amen. Y'all clap those hands for the Lord this morning. Woo, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. All right, kids, you are dismissed to Children's Church. And Malcolm said, yeah, amen. If you got your Bibles, let's go to Luke's Gospel. Luke's Gospel in chapter 24. And I want to, if it's all right with y'all, do a little bit of a Bible study this morning, if that's okay. Because I want us to pay attention a little bit to what we're seeing post-resurrection, as Jesus has been revealing himself to the disciples. But it sounds a lot like what Jesus had already been doing. I love the passage because I intended just to talk about this backside in verse 36 down to verse 49, but I want to piece a little bit together of this passage on the road to Emmaus, okay? Now, the road to Emmaus is interesting for a few reasons because, number one, we're about to hear about some disciples that you may not have heard of before, okay? Hear about this brother named Clopas, and you may not. The reason I love this passage so much is because when Jesus starts revealing himself, post resurrection, he reveals himself to people who he did not. How do we say this? Who we see highlighted in Scripture. We know about the 12 disciples, okay? We know about that. We know about Jesus' time with them and their specific ministry. We even know about the ladies. But it's the fact that Jesus showed himself to the ladies first, and then even in this road to Emmaus account to people who are not necessarily what I like to call main characters. Like, they're a part of the story, but they didn't necessarily, you didn't know their name till now. It's like the extra in your favorite TV show that looks kind of familiar. They always in the episode, but they never say anything. Clopas is one of those people who's always, if there was a docuseries, if you will, around the life of Jesus, Clopas would be in it, but he didn't have no speaking parts. But now he does. I wanted to show you a little bit. I think there's a reason why Jesus was showing himself to these people first. Because, hear me when I say this. Is it ever, let me say it this way. Have y'all ever gotten news from somebody and my grandma used to say it, now that baby ain't got no reason to lie to me. You know what I'm saying? Meaning somebody else who's a main character may have, well, of course they would paint the picture this way, or of course they will be biased because they're close. But when there's an outlying character, see what I'm saying? When there's an outlying character in this, it's like, well, this don't make a whole lot of sense. I think Jesus is working in the inverse order here, because as he's revealing himself to these folks, it's this. I want to make sure, hear me good, I want to make sure that the folks who saw me first, all right? The folks who saw me first are not the people that everybody else saw me with all the time. Watch it. I want to make it, because hear me. You got to realize what's happening around the resurrection. I'll show you a second. But what's happening around the resurrection is that they think that the disciples stole Jesus' body. What they think that they're trying to do is a modern day version of Weekend at Bernie's. What they think is going to happen is that the disciples are going to steal the body of Jesus, walk around with somebody and act like the body is alive, or try to play some Houdini trick. Okay? So meaning, it would make sense if the first people to everybody else here, look, I'm trying to give you how people talk. Well, of course they saying he resurrected. First people he came to was those disciples he was with. Of course they're gonna say he alive, because if he ain't alive, then it messed up all the stuff they've been doing. See what I'm saying here? Everybody else assumes that when Jesus gets up, if he gets up, that the first people he gonna pull up on is the disciples. And to everybody else, it would assume, okay, well, we think he's gonna steal the body. And we think they're gonna steal the body. We think they're gonna act like he's alive, but he's not really alive. You see? And so it's kind of the hidden ball trick, if you will. Like, we're gonna steal the body. We're going to say, oh, you just missed him. He was right here, but he gone. See what I'm saying? But I'm going to show you here. Show some passage. But it's the fact that he talks to the ladies first and to this cat named Clopas that you've never heard about before. Like, who are you talking about? I want to read the passage to you, and I'm going to show you everything that happens here. Okay. That very day, two of them were going to a village named Emmaus, 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about all the things that had happened. While they were talking or discussing together, Jesus himself drew near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. He said to him, "What's this conversation you were holding with each other as you walk?" And as they stood still, looking sad, one of them named Cleopas answered him, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened here in these days?" And he said to them, "What things?" And they said to him, "Concerning Jesus of Nazareth, the man who was a prophet and mighty indeed in word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and rulers delivered him up to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and beside all this, it is now the third day since these things happened. Moreover, some of our women of our company amazed us. They were at the tomb early in the morning, and when they did not find his body, they came back saying that they had even seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said it, but him, Lord Jesus, watch this, but him they did not see." Catch the irony there? It's funny here. Jesus is playing coy. Come on, Jesus, don't do that. Don't do that. Don't do that. What things? Jesus, you slick, don't do that. You hear about what's going on? Well, what happened? Jesus, really? Well, what happened? You know, Jesus of Nazareth. Who that is? Man, I'm telling you, the dude could preach. Man, he was healing people. He was supposed to redeem everybody, though, but man, he tripping. He ain't come through like he said he was going to do it. You know what I'm saying? And so he's hearing about all of this on purpose. Golly, Jesus wants firsthand information. Now, hear me good. Hear me good. I'm going to show you. Now, Jesus, fully God, fully man, resurrected body, he knows hearts, he understands thoughts, he already knows what's going on with them, and they don't even have to articulate it, okay? Not like Jesus needs to go and figure out what's going on, but it's important, hear me, it's not important for Jesus to have the information, it's important for us to have it. It's important for Jesus to communicate it in this way so that we could have the record. I'll show you in a second. So they talk. They're like, "We thought he's going to redeem Israel, but man, he ain't do it." And we sad. They sad. And then he said, "Well, man, the women went and they ain't seen him either." But we hear me. You can hear in the language that they don't believe the women. Did you hear it? They have went. But him they did not see. The women didn't come back and say, "He gone." No, they resurrected. It's you don't, but not no belief. Okay, so to Jesus, about to get talking. Interesting here. He said, "O foolish ones, slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them all the scriptures, the things concerning himself. They drew near to the village which they were going, and he acted as if he were going farther. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us. It's toward evening, the day is now far spent." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took the bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to them. Okay. This is the part, again, that shouts me. First of all, it's late. There's no why not stop. There is no Holiday Inn. There's no place for Jesus to go, for travelers to go this late. All right. It's not like they were being weird by asking him to come stay. Okay. You do remember Passover's going on. There's still travelers around. They know that people are still needing a place to stay. Like if you're trying to go back to the city, they assumed, or trying to go further, they assumed like, well, he got a spot to go to, but it's late. He ain't gonna make it. Just stay with us, man. But this is the part that got me. How is Jesus invited to dinner and he's the one blessing the food? Think about that. How is it that the invited guest officiates the blessing of dinner? Why? Maybe one, because they've been having Bible study with him all day long, listening to him. But it just thought it was funny. Like, Jesus, like, wait, not Cleopas and them blessing the food and breaking it and saying, "Oh, come on, visitor." No, like, enough to where, like, man, this guy, he, you know what, Rev, we'll let you bless the food. Go ahead, bless the food, Rev. And when he blessed the food and he broke it, verse 31, and their eyes were open and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened up the scriptures?" And they rose that same hour and returned to Jerusalem. Okay, first thing, Jesus teaches, okay? He enters, watch this. Watch how Jesus is about to do evangelism, discipleship, and fellowship all together at the same time. Watch it. He walks with them first before he says anything about who he is and what he's doing. He just walks with them. Don't miss that. We try to read over stuff. He just walks with them. What's going on? What y'all talking about? Pick that up. What y'all talk about? What's going on? Man, this is what's happening in the world, man. You heard about this? Oh, man, that's crazy. Oh, real? Man, heard about this Jesus, dude. Okay, I'm trying to make sense of what's going on in the world. Then Jesus opens up the scriptures. Watch me. Don't listen. Don't miss it. Jesus opens up the scriptures to these brothers to help them make sense of what's going on in their world. Don't overlook this. I know this is post-resurrection story, but don't overlook this. They are sad, trying to make sense of what is going on in their world. And Jesus pulls up to talk to them, asks, "What y'all doing? What's going on? This was going on in my world, man." Huh. Listens and says, "Let me tell you, wait, let's talk about the scriptures regarding this." If then after that, here's what happens. He's nice enough, kind enough, whatever it was that he said, which was good to them, they listened enough to say, "Man, come over to eat." And then when they sat down to eat, they recognized Jesus. Okay, Jesus walks with them. He has a purpose, we know this, but he walks with them. You catching me here? He walks with them. Evangelism is not a tract, it's a walk. Discipleship's not a tract, it's a walk. Fellowship is a walk, walks with them, talks, hears about what's going on with them. He's not arrived. It's me. What's on your heart? I'm so glad that Jesus walks with me and then asks me what's on my heart. He doesn't just immediately give me straight to the answer. Talk it out. What's on your heart? Man, let me tell you, this is what happened. Gives us the scriptures, breaks bread, their eyes were opened. This is different. Wait. Remember, the hour is already late. Okay? So look at this passage. They said to each other, did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened up to us the scriptures? Verse 33, and they rose that same hour and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, the Lord has risen indeed and has appeared to Simon. And they told what they had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of the bread. Verse 36. As they were talking about these things,
golly,
as they were talking about these things, Jesus shows up. Wait a minute. Let's go backwards. All day long, you've been walking with Jesus on this road. Y'all been talking. Y'all get down to eat. Listen to the language. He took the bread, he broke it, and he blessed it. Does it sound familiar? Last Supper, he took the bread, he broke it, and he blessed it. And then they recognized him. When they recognized him, he left. Why? Watch this. Because he's getting ready for the other part of the reunion. Here's what happens. They leave while it's late. This is dangerous. Leaving while it's late. Go pull up on the boys. Hey, man, he up. He up, man. Man, you lying. Look at you. They were talking about these things. Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, peace to you. Now, let me walk here. Here's my all that to the point. First point, y'all, it's real. It's real. Jesus, watch this, is in a resurrected body. This is different than regular old Jesus. Now, I ain't never calling Jesus regular, okay? I'm just saying Jesus in a resurrected body is different than what we got, okay? In a resurrected body. Hey, y'all, it's me. Wait. So it's real. And look. Peace to you. But they were startled and frightened and thought they saw a spirit. He said, why are you troubled? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look, Jesus shows up, shows them it's him, and then addresses what they feel off jump. Like, hey, don't worry. It's me. Don't let these doubts rise in your heart. And here is why. Are you ready? He'd been gone 3 days, and the noise of the outside world has already reached them. Why? Because not just right here, but all throughout the early church, here's this word that keeps popping up, Gnosticism. Why? This God that you're talking about is immaterial. He doesn't really exist. There's no matter to him. There's no meat on his bones. You're talking about an illusion. It's an imagination. This Jesus that you're thinking about, let me put it in your lap, is your version of a hologram. This ain't real Jesus. This is hologram Jesus. This is a ghost y'all talking to. Ain't a real body. That ain't real. And all of the early church, y'all is so good, struggled with the idea. Was that really him or was it a ghost? So just hear me. The disciples didn't just need it for then. They needed it for later. godly. When the work continued, when they're prone to walk away from it, when people are talking about them and lying on them and saying the church is false and they're leading people astray and that this Jesus wasn't real, they don't just need it for this moment. They need it for the following moments. They need it to understand that this resurrection was real. And since it was real, then we can rest on whatever he said is also real. Jesus doing this is important so that what we are doing can continue. We ain't talking about a fictitious story. This actually happened. And they needed that for their hearts then and later. They needed it for their hearts then. We need it for our hearts right now. I needed to know that the firsthand eyewitnesses didn't see a hologram. They felt him. He ain't real. And the rest of the people, listen, you can't tell me. You can't tell me no different what God has done for me. You can't tell me no different what God has done for me. I'm a living witness. I'm proof of what God has done for me. Meaning I'm a firsthand eye account witness of what God has done in my life. You cannot shake my firsthand experience with him. And since you can't shake my firsthand experience with him, there ain't nothing that you can say to persuade me otherwise that he ain't who he says he is. They needed this. We need this. I needed to know, man, was it a ghost? Don't you think some of us still ask the same questions? Was he real? Baby, I want to show you that from the scriptures that the disciples were even asking the same question. Is it for real you? He says, hey, listen, don't let those things come somewhere in your heart. No. Why are you doubting? See my hands, see my feet, that it is I myself. Touch me and see. For a spirit does not have flesh and bones that you see that I have. He's saying, look, this is real. This is for real me. And he said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they disbelieve for joy and were marveling, he said to them, have you anything here to eat? I'm about to shout on that in just a second, but hold on, just a minute. Just a minute. When their doubts were rising in their heart, he meets them in their doubts. When I'm tempted to think that he doesn't care, he meets me in my doubts. It's me. Why are you tripping? It's me. Now let me show you it's me. Let me come look. Look here. Look at this. This is real. It's me. Quit tripping. It's all right, y'all. I'm here. I know what they said. But look here. I know what they said. I know what they told y'all. I know they told you that you won't steal my body. How you gonna steal me? You ain't know where I was. I know they said I wasn't real. I know they are. I know they're making up lies about me right now to get you and others to not believe. But so that you are not tripping in your doubts, come here. Feel. Look. Touch. They still didn't get it. Still confused. They're marveling now. Think about this. Why? He's in a resurrected body for one. This is a different Jesus. But two, I can't believe you did it. You did it. In that moment, it's everything else you said was facts then. You did it. Wait a minute. Wait, you did it. What does that mean? They are tripping. Look, watch. And then, And then he says, do you have a piece of fish? Everything in here to eat. They gave him a piece of broiled fish. He took it and ate it before them. Verse 44, and then he said to him, these are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled. Then he opened their minds to them to understand the scriptures. And he said to them, thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance and forgiveness of sin should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. And behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you, but stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high. Watch how Luke sets up these accounts. Ready? In both settings, there's doubt. He meets them in their doubt. What does he then do with them? He teaches over a meal. Wait, but this time Jesus eats. Jesus eats for a couple of reasons. Number one, to then prove this is a body. This is a body. I hope that the human element too, he was also hungry. Like that would just bless my whole heart. You know what I'm saying? Like, man, it's been a long day, man. I got some Kool-Aid, some feel, you know what I mean? Like, let me get some. And that blesses me because it's real. Ghosts don't eat. I do. I ain't no ghost. I'm real. But then it became back to normal. What they've been doing, Jesus in resurrection comes back, and the way that they can for sure know this really is him, because we've been doing this all the time. What we've been doing? We've been sitting down teaching, and we've been having fellowship eating. What we've been doing? We've been teaching, explaining the scriptures, everything concerning, pointing towards me. And then we do that, we got a meal. The way that Jesus was able to reveal himself to them was in body and in practice. This is how you know it's me. What did we just do? What did we just do? I explained in teaching if there was a meal had here. I don't want to insert nothing in the scripture right here, but I would hope that they ain't let him eat by himself. I would hope that if there was fish already there, somebody had cooked already and had it ready. I would hope that they would have gathered around together and put a little remoulade sauce on it on top, you feel me? I would hope so. Teaching, meal, and eyes are opened. Come here. How will they be able to see Jesus? Hear me good, y'all. Keep teaching. Keep gathering for meals, and eyes will open. You ain't got to complicate it. That's all. Pastor, that's all I know how to do. That's all right. You're doing just like Jesus did. There are times when I want to think, like, this all you want me to do? I mean, well, Vince, yeah. Hear me. Y'all, can I just share this from my heart just for a second? I think sometimes that we expect churches to function outside of their scope. We want the church to do everything else except what it was designed to do. A pastor is measured, and churches are measured, ministries are measured by their effectiveness and all of the resources that they have to offer, not in the teaching. Well, if they do this, they do this. That's great. That's great. And I'm sure that comes from what's been birthed out of Jesus' teachings. We need it. But y'all, let me just say something. Do what you know to do. Do what you know to do. Can I tell you something? How did you recognize Jesus? When you responded to the gospel, how did you recognize him? Think about it. When you respond to the gospel, how did you recognize him? When you're doing something for the Lord that makes you come alive, does that make you recognize Jesus? Do that. When I sing, I come alive. Do that. That opens eyes. When I teach from the word of God, I feel like I come alive. Well, Vincent, do that. And eyes will be open. Anytime I'm serving the Lord's church, whether it's a cook, whether it's folding up a chair, whether it's just texting somebody, I've been praying for you. Do that. And eyes will be opened. Quit doubting what God gave you in the simplistic. It's going to work. God is still going to use the simple things to open blinded eyes. Do that. They're going to do, yeah, do that. Do that. Y'all, it's a beeline to this thing too. There's, we about to celebrate another table. Because the Lord's Supper set us up for the big table. Gonna be a day. There's gonna be a day. Because right now we're looking through a glass darkly. But one day we gonna see him as he is. You know what that's called? Eyes open. But until then, I'm gonna celebrate this table that he gave me. So scripture teaches us that a man or woman ought to examine themselves to see if there's any unclean thing in them. Not just in sin. If there's any beef that you got with somebody that needs to be squashed, lay it down before the Lord before you jump in here on this table. I'm so glad we get a chance to come to this. I'm so glad, y'all. I'm so glad. This is a picture. This is a picture. Every time I gather and get a chance to do this, I feel like the shade gets a little bit lighter. Y'all, one day, and look, it's going to come sooner rather than later. I don't mean to be this person, but can I tell you, you ain't promised walking out of this room. You not. So since that is the case, why would you not want to be ready to sit at that table for forever? Then celebrate now. Take a moment and pray. I'll give us instructions. Then we will pray, give announcements, and be dismissed. Amen. I sing praises to your name, O Lord. Praises to your name, O Lord, for your name is great and greatly to be praised. I wonder why that's in there. Sing praises to your name, O Lord. Praises to your name, O Lord. For your name is great and greatly to this part too. I give glory to your name.
For I received from the Lord, but I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, he took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's eat the bread together. In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let's take the cup together. One day closer.
Praises to your name, O Lord. Praises to your name, O
stuck on the name. I don't know why. Maybe I lost you. I'm stuck on that name. I don't know if you've ever wondered what your seat gonna look like. I don't know if you've ever wondered who will be around you or who gonna be waiting for you. I get emotional about a lot of things. And if I'm being very honest, my feeble, finite mind can't grasp the concept of eternity. Like that's 36 years old, been pastoring all this time, and that still boggles me. But I do know what gives me some security is that he saved the seat for me. Got my name on it. I don't care if it's aluminum, I don't care if it's plastic. Phil, I don't care if it's a kitty chair. As long as it's got my name on it. Till he comes. Okay, all right. Mind together. Announcements. Sorry, I went all the way off. Connections. Again, y'all, listen. This is not just for our first time guest. This is a way for us to get a chance to follow up with you if we have not been following up with you. Because you know that Sister Daisy, and or myself, or Sister Nicole, somebody, listen, you out of here, or MIA or something, somebody will check on you, amen, because we love you, want to check in, see how you're doing, and so not just for our first-time guests, if there are any here, but for our family, we want to make sure that we get a chance to follow up and connect with you, all right, and so if you want to worship through giving, you can do that as you exit the door via Square, the envelopes are there. You can still text to give and give online. This Wednesday, May 4th, we'll be kicking off a new Bible study. It starts at 6. This is an 8-week study, walking through prayer. So I'm really excited about this study and getting a chance to get back together with our church family. Amen. It's been too long, so getting back is going to be really, really good for us. Pastor Los sends his best, and he's going to holler back at us about our next ministry gathering, whether I missed the IHOP. Hope we get a chance to go back. Amen. We got to miss IHOP when I'm gone. So hope we get a chance to go back. So follow up with him if you have information. Same thing with Sister Nicole, May 15th. May 15th at 6 o'clock. Again, chapters 11 and 12 on the pursuit of holiness, okay? Chapters 11 and 12. Am I missing anything else? No? Okay. If I did, we'll post and we'll share and or we'll text you like we try to do, all right? Y'all, it's been a great day at the Lord's house. God's been so good to us. Ooh, he's been good to us. Let's pray. We'll be dismissed. Father, we thank you for what our eyes have seen and what our ears have heard. God, you've been so good to us, and for that we say thank you. Now, God, as we ready to leave this place, God, we're going to need this same power to take us through our day and our week. God, work lies ahead of us. School lies ahead of us. There's so much that lies ahead of us that will pull our attention away from this good gospel. There's so much out there that's going to pull us away into thinking that what we have heard here today, what we have sang about here today, is not in fact real. God, would you remind us in every waking moment that you're real? None of this is in vain. And give us what we need out of your gospel to handle whatever life may throw at us. Now may the grace of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with each of us henceforth, now and forever. And the people of God said, amen. Hey, I actually did think of one more. I don't know if it's an actual announcement, but I'm going to make sure I say it anyway. Tell us your graduation date one more time. May 7th. And Cam, graduation date, May 17th. All right? So, church fam, we support family. Amen. So we got some, Lord help, some gift cards, Amen, y'all. But say amen, somebody. And showing up and loving on our people, all right? And so we celebrate achievement here. And we want to celebrate these two of our own who love and serve well. And so May 7th and May 17th. Amen. Govern thine selves accordingly. All right, you are dismissed.